Division 10 is Mecklenburg, Union, Cabarrus, Stanley, and Anson counties, and you'll hear me say Division 10 a lot during this presentation. The origin of this is the Scarborough happened to see me give a little talk about the new strategic transportation investments formula that was passed by the General Assembly last year. And she thought this group would find that interesting. And since, again, the title is Outreach and Community Affairs, I'm exactly where I should be this morning to talk about this. So to get started, I do bring you greetings on behalf of Governor Pat McCrory, our secretary, Tony Taylor. I'm bringing you greetings. You know, our governor is former mayor, and of course, Secretary Tony Tatis, former Brigadier General in the United States Army. And then there's my boss, Division Engineer Lewis Mitchell, who is also a Lieutenant Colonel in the Army Reserve. So I like showing off that I'm working for a Lieutenant Colonel. But there's this military bearing about the Department of Transportation these days, with a former Brigadier General as the Secretary, and a former Colonel as the Commissioner of the Department of Motor Vehicles, turning that organization around. And like I said, I've got a Lieutenant Colonel for a boss in the division. Sadly, I never served, but I admire the dedication that shows. All right, here's the quick outline. I have to do a little history. I can't talk about any kind of policy without providing some sort of historical framework. It's just a curse. But then we'll delve into the meat of strategic transportation investments as they stand today with the formula and the projects in this area, so you'll know what is likely to happen with this formula. And then hit on some future issues to be looking at when it comes to transportation funding in North Carolina. So quickly on history, we have been known off and on for a good bit of time over the past 100, 110 years or so as the Good Road State. The effort to call us the Good Road State really began in the early 1900s, but a key date that you might find interesting is in 1921, when a governor from Mecklenburg County by the name of Cameron Morrison persuaded the General Assembly to pass a huge bond referendum for the time to dramatically improve the highway network in North Carolina. That network looked like this in 1922. Don't be fooled. Some of those are unpaved roads. In fact, most of the highway network in the early 20s was unpaved, and the point of that bond was to get them paved. The idea was we'd have a solid paved road connecting all 100 county seats. That was kind of a goal at the time. Another date to remember, and I'm not going to inundate you with dates, but they're relevant. 1931, in the throes of the Great Depression, lots of counties across North Carolina were going bankrupt, and one of the problems they had was they could not maintain their road network. So it's in 1931 that North Carolina becomes one of the few states to completely take over the highway and road network from counties. Most other states you'll find, you'll see there are county roads and city roads and state roads. In North Carolina, there are only state roads and city roads. Counties are not involved with roads at all. And this is a function of what happened during the Depression and the state deciding, all right, we'll do it. We want a uniform system of roads as much as possible across the state. We're not going to leave it up to counties to manage. As a result, North Carolina has the second largest state-maintained highway network in the country. We are second only to Texas. There were some years when we trade places with Texas. Texas, I think, is probably going to have us beat for a while now, but we'll stay comfortably in second. We have about 80,000 centerline miles statewide. A little quick bit of jargon in the transportation business. You talk about centerline miles or you talk about lane miles. Centerline miles is just a mile of road, no matter how wide it is. Lane miles is when you get into how wide they are, and we generally track things for this sort of thing by centerline miles. In the division, where we are here, we've got about 5,000 centerline miles of the state highway network in the five counties. And what that looks like in the city of Charlotte, this is from the virtual Charlotte website, the streets in red are state maintained, even though they are within the boundary of the city of Charlotte. Some of those you would expect, the interstates, the U.S. route system, the state highway system like NC-16, NC-49, that sort of thing. But you can also see that Woodlawn and Eastway are state maintained. There's a stretch of railroad in South Charlotte that's state maintained. We've got a lot of points up in the northwest part of Charlotte that are still state-maintained roads, even though they're within the boundaries of the city of Charlotte. It's just the way we operate in this state. Now, rapidly kind of bringing us up to speed locally, I'm going to skip over 68 years of history and talk about 1989. A governor from Mecklenburg County by the name of Jim Martin led a tremendous amount of reform in highway funding. An increase in the state gas tax provided the bulk of funding to the Highway Trust Fund, and that statute also created the equity formula, which guided how money would be spent across the state. The equity formula was based on a plan that then Governor Martin had, that everyone in North Carolina should be pretty close to a four-lane divided highway. We wanted to build out the intrastate network. So the equity formula was geared towards building out the existing network, which for 1989 was a reasonable thing to expect. The equity formula divided funding across seven different regions. I'm going to spend a little time on this map because this map guides a lot of what the Transportation Department does. There are 14 highway divisions, and each highway division is paired to form a region. What the equity formula did was divide highway trust fund dollars by region according to a formula that took population sort of into account, but also was geared towards building out the intrastate system within each region. One of the big winners of the equity formula in terms of construction funding was Terrell County in the eastern part of the state, because they had a really massive stretch of US 64 to construct through Terrell County. And so they got, for a county that doesn't have a lot of people, they got a lot of funding, but that road network was considered crucial for the time, and so it was done. Quick little jaunt into history. For those of you looking at these 14 highway districts, seeing that Mecklenburg is paired with Stanley and Anson, but not with Gaston County, who you would think has something to do with us. Another little dip into history. I have to do this because I enjoy it. The reason those 14 divisions exist with the boundaries they do can be illustrated by this little fade to the past. This is the 1939 dedication plaque for the Stanley County Prison Camp. And you'll notice there at the bottom listed the State Highway and Public Works Commission. Because in the 30s, when the state took over the road network, it used prison labor to build it and to maintain it. So the 14 divisions of the North Carolina Highway, or Division of Highways in the Department of Transportation, are based on where the prisons were in the 30s. Now, we don't use prison labor anymore for this sort of thing, but the lines stay the same. So the headquarters for Division 10 is actually in Albemarle in Stanley County, even though Charlotte and Mecklenburg are the largest counties in the division. That's just where it is, and the amount of DOT infrastructure in Albemarle is pretty sizable. Hello, good morning. All right, another confusing map, but one that's very important because it's another factor in terms of understanding funding of transportation priorities in North Carolina. When federal money is involved, the feds want to make sure there's local input. It, quite wisely, I think, didn't just want to send money to the state capitals and let the folks in the state capitals spend it however they wanted to. So what you see on this confusing map is a patchwork quilt of federally identified metropolitan planning organizations, and then their counterparts in the rural areas, the rural planning organizations. These are made up of local elected officials. City Council member Vi Lyles, for example, is Charlotte's representative on the Metropolitan Planning Organization for Charlotte, the Charlotte Regional Transportation Planning Organization, or CARTPO, because it wouldn't be government if we didn't have an acronym and a way to pronounce it. Which it replaced the Mecklenburg Union, Mecklenburg Planning Organization, or MUMPO. So we don't have MUMPO anymore. We have CARTPO. It's CARTPO. But you can see how this adds to the complexity of transportation funding. The state is organized into 14 highway divisions that are paired into seven regions, but the feds want feedback from metropolitan regions. That, as you can see, my favorite example is the poor folks in the Cabarrus-Rowan Metropolitan Planning Organization. It's just those two counties, Cabarrus and Rowan. Cabarrus County's in Division 10. Rowan County is in Division 9. They're in different regions, different divisions, different traffic, different engineers they're working with, different plans they're working with, but it's one body that's having to make these decisions across boundaries with different pots of money. So there's that to deal with. Rounding up our survey of history, reform really began under Governor Perdue's administration 2009 to 2013 in two major areas, design build and project prioritization. Previously, we operated on this pattern of do a contract to design a project, and once it's designed, do a contract to build it. Well, under Governor Perdue, she pushed for the notion of design-build contracts and award one contract for both activities, and that led to some significant savings. For example, this is a fantastic, in my opinion, rendering of a delightful interchange. Yes, I'm saying things like delightful interchange these days, working for the DOT. But this is the turbine interchange at 85 and 485 in the northeast part of the county. It is partially open to traffic now. It will be completely open in December when the last leg of 485 opens. And it's just kind of amazing. Not least of which, because under the design build contract, when this design was proposed by the contractors, it saved $40 million on the interchange alone. Interchanges are expensive, and the design build contracts save $40 million. So that's an innovation that we're continuing, of course, to ensure that we spend taxpayer money as wisely as possible and save as much as we can. Also, Governor Perdue, in her second executive order, reformed the Department of Transportation, and in this section, the text is just there for illustration. The key part is that she directed the Secretary of the Department of Transportation, Gene Conte at the time, to implement throughout the department a professional approval process for all highway construction programs. Sad to say that this was kind of new, a professional approval process for the entire department about programs. That was very significant in terms of setting the stage for where we are today. And where we are today is now with the Strategic Transportation Investments Bill, which was House 817, passed overwhelmingly in the Senate, overwhelmingly in the House. I see a senator, I see a representative, I hope you voted for it. I didn't look up the individual records. And signed June 26, 2013. We're going to get into a little more about the details of the STI, but just to give you a broad sense of the impact, under the old equity formula, for the next 10 years, we were looking at constructing 175 projects statewide that would bring in over 170,000 jobs. That would be spending $15 billion over the next 10 years. With STI, we're getting 371 projects, over 240,000 jobs with the same $15 billion. What STI shows is that when you add specific aspects of data to analyze what projects to build, you see that you can get sometimes a bigger bang for your buck with a smaller project. So whereas the equity formula in trying to build out this interstate network tended to make people think about big projects, STI shows that smaller projects scattered around can have a significant impact as well.